November is around the corner and the whole world is watching to see who will win the US presidential race between Democrat and former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton and Republican real estate tycoon Donald Trump. The world watches because our fates, as we were acutely reminded by the domino effect that characterized the global economic recession, are closely interlinked with the health and stability of the US economy. We watched the first presidential debate in September that many say Hillary Clinton won, which was followed by the vice presidential nominee debate in which Trump's VP Mike Pence is said to have recovered the ground lost. And now just this Sunday, in the second presidential debate, the candidates went head to head again in Missouri before the final and possibly decisive debate next Wednesday in Las Vegas. Many are surprised that the divisive Donald Trump has even made it this far, but now have to ask themselves the terrifying question, what happens if he does indeed win? The pundits say that the general political climate in the US has shifted towards a more protectionist stance on international trade since the global financial crisis, and that actually both presidential candidates have vowed to pay special attention to the middle-class American worker and have taken a stronger stance against free trade, threatening to unravel Obama's legacy. A legacy in which we as Africans saw the extension of the African Growth and Opportunity Act, AGOA, to the year 2025, beyond the two terms of any US president. Although any future president can still have a significant impact on the terms and conditions of the agreement. AGOA is an agreement that extends preferential access for 37 African countries to export a wide range of goods duty-free to the US, and is now one that may hang in the balance, along with proposed mega-regional trade agreements such as the Trans-Pacific Partnership, TPP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Agreement, TTIP, and various bilateral free trade agreements. To better understand what the implications of either Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton win would be for the region, and specifically Botswana, we speak to a South African international relations pundit, Franz Krunier, who has, among a number of things, facilitated scenario and strategy planning sessions for a number of big corporates that have invested in South Africa. In a telephone interview we had with Mr. Krunier recently, he said Trump's coming to power may raise serious question marks about the future prospects for the American economy, which is itself in a very weak state. That the risk is, when you look at the unstable nature of much of the world's economy and the great unanswered question of quantitative easing, if you add Trump's protectionist economics into the mix, potentially you have a very tough, long global economic recovery ahead. But that the frustrating thing about Mr. Trump is that you don't know how much of what he says you can believe, as many of the positions he has taken up would seem to contradict views he has held earlier in his life. Mr. Krunier argues that whether in fact Donald Trump is going to introduce the degree of protectionism implicit in that promise about the Mexican wall remains to be seen. But if he is true to what he says he intends to do, it introduces serious new uncertainties into a global economy that is already wracked with such uncertainties. He tells us what he foresees in terms of America's relationship with our corner of the world if Mr. Trump was to win these presidential elections, pointing out that in the past, Republican presidencies have actually worked out well for the continent of Africa.
You know, the Republican presidents always do more for Africa than Democratic presidents do. I think one of the reasons is that it's assumed that Democrats are on Africa's side, but initiatives such as PEPFAR, for example, Agreement, which has been particularly beneficial to a lot of Southern African economies, have always had strong Republican support. I think that Mr. Trump on Africa could arguably be a benefit to the continent. What Africa, I don't think, needs is another American administration that sees the continent as a developmental issue, as somewhere that needs help and support and advice. I think if you see an American administration that takes a far more geostrategic, harder view on Africa, a view that seeks to advance American interests and African interests at the same time through trade, investment and the like, and not a view that sort of paternalistically looks down on Africa as a basket case in need of advice from Americans. I think that type of change in America's Africa policy probably will more likely come out of a Republican administration than it will come out of a Democrat administration. So I think for Africa, there's potential in Mr. Trump. Of course, that's qualified by my warnings earlier that Mr. Trump's track record is one in which you don't know how much of what he says you can believe and what he commits to do, how much of that will happen. And if he does set off on a protectionist course for America's economy, then some of those benefits that might otherwise accrue to Africa, such as the AGOA agreement, the agreement is intact for several years to come. But a similar type of approach might not materialize out of Mr. Trump himself. It's important, I think, to distinguish Mr. Trump from the Republican establishment and the type of relationship that Africa might have with a future Republican president as opposed to a Democrat president.
Is our guest saying that a Republican Trump, if he forgoes his protectionist stance, has the potential of benefiting the region?
I think the weakness in American policy towards Africa is that it regards Africa as a basket case that requires assistance and aid and advice. It doesn't see Africa as a geostrategic, as an area of great geostrategic importance. You know that if China's not growing at the rates that it claims to be growing at, then Africa is now the world's fastest growing emerging market, Southern Africa. If you take South Africa out, it's performing very badly, then Southern Africa's growth looks even better. In terms of issues such as global energy, Africa's production of oil, for example, can rival that of many countries in the Middle East. Its resource stores are incredibly important. It's the answer, Africa, to the global protein crisis, that as people grow wealthy around the world, they run out of the land they need to farm in order to supply protein demand. And Africa's untapped agricultural potential is enormous. At the same time, urbanizing Africa and the emergence of Africa's middle class presents fantastic new opportunities to fast-moving consumer goods companies around the world. And I think a policy to Africa that reflects its growing strategic importance, as opposed to a policy that sees Africa as a sort of a global backwater that needs help and assistance, such a more enlightened Africa policy is more likely to emerge from the Republican side of the American political divide than I think it's likely to emerge from the Democratic side.
Conversely, what is to be expected if the Democratic nominee Hillary Clinton wins? I have read that both candidates, although having very different visions for the US economy, with Trump focusing on cutting taxes, eliminating regulation, and ending trade deals, and Clinton, on the other hand, looking to raise taxes on the wealthy, increase spending on job training, and lower taxes on companies that hire more Americans, they are both less open to free trade than Obama has been. Could trade deals such as AGOA be in jeopardy?
I think AGOA is fairly well intact, and I don't see any threat to AGOA coming out of a Clinton administration. The unknown quantity of Trump, and he can't actually do much himself about the AGOA agreement, but the unknown quantity that Trump and his administration is, there'll be more questions around AGOA, not so much with Mrs. Clinton. I think she understands the geostrategic importance of an agreement such as that, which is really the only remaining influence that America is able, positive influence that America is able to hold over Africa at the moment, has its origins in AGOA. So I think AGOA is very much intact. She probably also has the problem, though, that should she win the American election, I think that she's going to, particularly after comments that Mr. Trump made about her. The trouble she has is that she'll also have to appeal to Mr. Trump's constituency. And that middle America feel that the establishment in Washington and the economic elite of America have sold them short, have exported their jobs, have sent many of those jobs as factory workers to Asia, and want some of that back. And the risk there is certainly that she also starts to reflect some of the, well, politically, I think she'd have to try and reflect some of the protectionist measures that Mr. Trump suggests. Whether she can pull it off politically to play that game while at the same time leaving trade measures fairly free and open, I think that's a challenge that faces her. I think the understanding in her administration would be fairly strong that an America that builds a wall around itself, even if it's in just a figurative sense, and becomes island or fortress America in an increasingly unstable and integrated world, is in the long term a recipe for the decline of America itself. It has to engage with the world. It has to trade more aggressively with it. She just has to manage the blowback that will come from Trump's popular statements about the export of American jobs to the rest of the world.
Welcome back to First Issues. Over the past few weeks, we've been discussing business practices in different countries. And tonight, we turn our attention to a small country that, like Botswana, is landlocked, bordered by Italy in the south, Germany in the north, France in the west, and Austria in the east. But unlike our country, boasts a population of more than 8 million people, according to the latest United Nations estimates. The economy of Switzerland is one of the world's most stable, as it was ranked first in the 2015 Global Innovation Index. The country boasts a typical first world model with regards to its economic sectors. Only a small minority is involved in the agricultural sector, while a larger minority is in the manufacturing sector. This therefore leaves the majority of the working population involved in the services sector of the economy, that is 71% in 2012. The Swiss policy of long-term monetary security and political stability has made Switzerland a paradise for investment, creating an economy that highly depends on foreign investment. Switzerland has a mature market economy based on export-oriented machinery and electrical manufacturing of high-precision motors, generators, turbines, chemicals and pharmaceuticals, financial services, tourism, as well as export of electrical energy, primarily peak power produced by hydroelectric plants. It is one of the countries that possess an extensive industrial sector, with giants the likes of Nestle in food processing, Sika AG in chemical production, as well as Novartis and Roche in pharmaceuticals. Swiss Consul John Luber helps us unpack business practices as well as opportunities that may be found in the Swiss Confederation. Welcome back to the program as we continue to look at the business culture of a people renowned for being highly efficient as well as extremely punctual, the Swiss. Switzerland is one of the leaders in exports of high-end watches and clocks, leading many to wonder which came first, the precise timekeepers or the precise people. Our guest, Swiss Consul to Botswana John Luber, describes a nation that is orderly and considered. Their egalitarianism is made evident by the country's seven-member federal council, which serves as a collective head of state and doubles up as the country's cabinet. No one person has served as head of state since the 1800s. And if somebody is selected to be president, they only serve for 1 year. Truly unique. Our guest describes what other traits are unique to the operational structures and practices of Switzerland.
What practices or norms would you say characterize the professional world in Switzerland, or the working world?
One of the things that are key in Switzerland, I would say, is time. I think that's why they invented the watch, and Switzerland is well known for watches.
Yeah.
But time is a very key aspect. I mean, it is not appreciated if you're late. So there's a Swiss saying, if you're in time if you're 5 minutes ahead of time for a meeting, never after that. Mm-hmm. It's not appreciated if you're late. So time is a very important aspect. Another aspect would be that clients are really, there's a saying, like, the client is the king. So you take time, you acknowledge a client. When I walk into a supermarket here, people talk with one another. The client just sort of is one of a number, one feels, but that is not the culture practice in Switzerland. The clients are, people walk around you. They want to know, what is it that you want? What is it that you need? How can you help? Etc. So the client is really seen as a important aspect in the business world, because without clients you won't have business. And so that's a very key aspect in Switzerland, next to time. And maybe the third aspect would be quality. I think that's a very high ranking thing. Swiss are for quality. I remember my wife sharing the story that when they used to go buy things, or their dad said, go and buy a pair of shoes, when they got home, they were never asked how much did it cost. So then they wanted to know, where did you buy it? What kind of brand was it? So price was not as important as quality. And I think that's I sense that the Swiss really value good quality. And that's why Swiss chocolate is so very good, and the Swiss watches are so very good. And the Swiss machinery, I mean, in town, if you go through Chabarone, wherever there's a lift and you see the word Schindler, that's a Swiss name, Swiss brand. So there's a lot of quality that you can see, maybe behind the scenes, but there's a lot of Swiss precision and quality.
They have really branded themselves in that way, as you're saying. I think one of the first strong brands we have come to appreciate nationwide. When you see the Swiss brand even on beauty products, you think this must be very of such good standards. Now, what do you tell people, maybe even from Switzerland, who are looking to come to Botswana, maybe to expand their business or start a new one? What do you tell them to expect with regards to our business practices and culture?
One of the things I've appreciated in Botswana is an openness, the willingness to look at new things. It seems that there's a lot of opportunity, because it's a large country with a small population. Switzerland is a small country with a big population. So the competition is very high there. And it seems that, yeah, there's competition here, but there's a lot of space for other companies that would bring good quality products and things like that. So I think that's one of the things I'd say. And the other thing that I really appreciate, having experienced South Africa and Namibia, is the openness. Just, there's no color barriers in that I sensed, or it was very different to South Africa and Namibia.
The differences in the countries that you just mentioned, maybe as a result of the histories of those countries, with Botswana having had somewhat of a very peaceful transition to democracy than maybe Namibia and South Africa. But now, if you were to advise me, if I was looking to try my luck in Switzerland, what would you advise me to do? Which areas would be more likely open to me? You did say it's a smaller country with more people than Botswana, so competition is more high. How would you prepare me?
I would think that a key element that, because it's a very densely populated country, a lot of competition, I think the only way you would probably succeed is if you brought a special skill to the table. If you are hardworking, the Swiss are very hardworking. So you would have to prove that you are able to be with that pace, and really ambition is, people are really, they want to progress. So there's this way of just working hard at it. But so I would think with a special skill, a special degree, there's always opening. Of course, depending what area you're looking at, I mean, the financial world, there's a lot of big banks and things like that. So that could be a career path. Many people just come in and start as students and get to know the country and get to know the culture and see where are their openings. It is so diverse. Switzerland has so many opportunities. Because of the huge population, and they've really created a great economy where you could fit in if you brought in some special skills.
Thank you for tuning into our program once again. As is typically the case, we now read out the winning comment in response to our program from last week, one that featured the innovations being pioneered in Bunting by the young people behind the Pula Sports Development Association. Yolanda Megan wrote in on our Facebook page to say that it was fascinating to see what started as a dream finally taking shape and coming alive, that she was inspired, loves the fact that the park is eco-friendly, and cannot wait to see how its bio-toilets work. She finishes off by saying that the show was an eye-opener and that clearly one does not need to be loaded, as you can recycle whatever junk is in your reach. Thank you for your enthusiastic response, Yolanda. We look forward to rewarding similar comments or questions based on tonight's program with some first issues goodies. When visiting our Facebook page, make sure to participate in our ongoing poll to make sure we continue giving you good content. Until next week and another issue of interest, we bid you good night.